بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله الصحابي رضي الله عنه that we are about to discuss is famously known as one of the شعراء. His speciality was he was a poet of جناب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he would stand up to defend the honor and dignity of جناب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was none other than Hazrat Abdullah ibn Rawha ibn Tha'labah ibn Mr'i al-Qais radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, from the Khazraj tribe, al-Khazraji. For us to remember at least this much, Abdullah bin Rawha radiyallahu anhu, Allah give us tawfiq. He would stand up to defend Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What a noble task is that, wherein one stands up to defend the dignity of Islam and the honor of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's early efforts in Makkah Mukarramah, when he would meet the different tribes, and finally he then met the two men from Madinah Munawwara, namely Hazrat Rifa'a and Hazrat Mu'adh bin Afra. Then Allah's Nabi one night, it was the 11th year after Hijrah, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met six youngsters from Madinah Munawwara. Those six returned to Madinah Munawwara, and they returned to Rasulullah the next year, meaning 12th year after Nubuwa, with new brothers, five from the previous year and seven new brothers, and amongst those seven was none other than Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawha radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He always kept a very close ta'alluq with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He devoted his life to defending and praising Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's an interesting report wherein he says, one day I was in front of the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah's Nabi instructed me, say some words of poetry impromptu, meaning without former preparation, just say it now as you look at me. He says, I started uttering these words, إِنِّي تَفَرَّشْتُ فِيكَ الْخَيْرَ أَعْرِفُهُ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا خَانَنِ الْبَصَرُ أَنْتَ النَّبِيُّ وَمَنْ يُحْرَمْ شَفَاعَتَهُ يَوْمَ الْحِسَابِ لَقَدْ أَزْرَى بِهِ الْقَدَرُ فَثَبَّتَ اللَّهُ مَا آتَاكَ مِنْ حَسَنٍ تَثْبِيتَ مُوسَى وَنَصْرًا كَالَّذِي نُصِرُ. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was elated by these words, wherein Allah's Nabi gave him dua, may Allah keep you firm as well, O Abdullah. And in his words he says, O my Nabi, inni tafarrastu fika al-khayr. My foresight is clear that I can see definitely such goodness in you. My eye can never be incorrect. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are the Nabi of Allah, and he who is deprived of thy intercession on the day of judgment is certainly the most wretched of all. May Allah reward you and always keep you firm in the goodness he has given you, just like he kept Hazrat Musa alayhi salam firm. And may Allah give you the special nusra with which every Nabi of Allah, was helped and supported and strengthened thereby. Allah's Nabi gave him du'as of firmness and istiqama on deen when he heard these beautiful words of Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawha radiyallahu anhu. Hazrat Abdullah participated then in the bay'ah of Aqaba, wherein Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met the people of Medina. During those nights of Hajj, he was one participant there, and he also participated. So he's a veteran of Badr. His appellation was Abu Muhammad and also Abu Rawha. But he didn't have children. A famous Sahabi, Hazrat Nu'man bin Bashir radiallahu anhu, he was Hazrat Nu'man bin Bashir radiallahu anhu's khal. Khal means mother's brother. So Hazrat Nu'man bin Bashir radiallahu anhu's mother's brother was Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawha radiallahu anhu. And he was also a scribe of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And interestingly, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed him on certain occasions in charge of Madinah Munawwara. To be specific, it was the occasion of Badr al-Mu'id. Hazrat Abdullah participated in Badr, but there's another Badr called Badr Mu'id, because on the occasion of Badr, as there was a departure, which was Uhud, he participated in Uhud. As the Muslims departed and the Mushrikeen were leaving, they had an appointment that the next year we'll meet in the lands of Badr. Hazrat Abdullah was so obedient to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him out in Allah's way or for any task, he fulfilled those tasks to the best of his ability. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to fulfill a task amongst the Jews of Khaybar. He fulfilled that. And so obedient he was. One day he was coming towards Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah's Nabi from the minbar said to everyone, sit. He just heard Allah's Nabi's words, sit. And just where he was, he sat down on the spot. He didn't use his logic or anything else to say no. Allah's Nabi is referring to those in front of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The beloved of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was elated by this quality of Hazrat Abdullah. And Allah's Nabi said to him afterwards, زادك الله حرصا على طواعية الله وطواعية رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. May Allah increase you in enthusiasm over your obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the obedience of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. May Allah increase you with such enthusiasm. This is a quality Allah ta'ala loves, obedience. Hazrat Abdullah was known for such obedience, like all the Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم. Something else very and really interesting about him was he loved the majalis of Iman. Any gathering wherein Iman was discussed, Iman was the objective and Iman was the topic, and the gatherings of preservation of Iman, Hazrat Abdullah radiallahu anhu would love such gatherings. He would sit in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the preservation of Iman, and then he would go to the other Sahaba radiallahu anhum and say, come, let's sit in the gatherings of Iman. Let's sit to discuss Iman. Let's sit to protect our Iman. From here we learn the importance of worrying for our Iman. When someone complained to Abdullah bin Rawha, to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Abdullah bin Rawha, that look at him, he's calling people to sit in majalisun Iman. Allah's Nabi was so happy with his quality. Rahimallahu ibn Rawha. Innahu yuhibbul majalis allati tatabaha biha al-malaika. May Allah bless him with special mercies, because he loves the gatherings that malaika boast about. That means that Allah's Nabi was happy with gatherings when people sit and worry for their Iman, because Allah wants us to worry about our Iman. Allah in the Quran says, Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu, aminu billahi wa rasuli. O those who have Iman, preserve and protect your Iman. How do you say to one who's already partaking of a meal in your home, that have, partake, try this and try that, would you? Yes, you would. If he's eating in a manner that's inadequate, not even enough, or he's partaking a little and he's shy, you would want your guest to partake much more. You would want your guest to enjoy the ikram. So in the same way, sometimes we have some basic deen or basic Islam in us, or a little level of Iman. Allah wants us to have more Iman. Allah wants us to worry about our Iman. Even though if we have little Iman, it's little, we must aspire to have more Iman and love Iman and increase in our Iman. One brother, one person has a glass full of water. The second has a bucket full of water. The third has an entire pool or pond full. What one can do with the cup is much less than what can be carried out with the bucket. And then more so, nothing comparison to what one has in his pot, pond, or pool, or stream. Even though all have water, somebody has 10 rands, the other has 100, the other has 1,000, and the fourth has 100,000. So the one who has 10 rands has 10 rands, but what can be accomplished with the 10? In the same way, we want Allah's Jannah with little Iman. So Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawha would encourage and aspire to uplift Iman, teaching the Ummah the importance of Iman. This is why all the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would worry about each other's Iman. Hazrat Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, when people would visit him, because he taught Allah's deen in Kufa. He went to Kufa, he taught Allah's deen for years there. Then he returned to Medina Munawwara. So whenever the people of Kufa would come to Medina Munawwara and they would visit Hazrat Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he would take kar guzari, report back from them. And he would ask them about their condition. What would their condition be? What was their condition like? Among the questions he asked them, Hal tazawarun? Do you brothers, do you visit each other for Allah's sake? Do you visit each other for the pleasure of Allah? They say, we don't leave such a thing. If we don't see our brother, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ مِنَّا لَيَمْشِي عَلَىٰ قَدَمَيْهِ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْكُوفَةِ. One of us would aspire to go to the end of the city, and he would make sure he visits his brother. And then he would say, do you sit and discuss Iman? هَلْ تَجَالَسُونَ? They say, لَا نَتْرُكُ ذَلِكَ. We never leave such practices that you taught us. And Hazrat Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, as long as you sit
together worrying about iman and each other's iman, and as long as you visit each other and have concern and care for each other's iman, Allah will continue giving us goodness. لَن تَزَالُوا بِخَيْرٍ مَا فَعَلْتُمْ ذَلِكَ. Your condition of goodness will continue as long as these practices are alive in you. Allah give us tawfiq to worry and care for our iman, as Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawaha radiallahu anhu would teach the ummah. Alhamdulillah, there was an amazing relationship between the great Sahabi Hazrat Abu Darda and Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawaha radiallahu anhu. Hazrat Abu Darda's name was Uwaymir bin Malik radiallahu anhu. He, from his young days, he was devoted to idolatry, and he was a very prominent businessman in Medina Munawwara. One day he awakens early, he prepares his idol, washing it, bathing it, purifying it, perfuming it, and then he comes out to go to his trade, and he sees the streets of Medina Munawwara was filled with people. The followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum, were returning from Badr, and he notices the large exodus of captives from Quraysh. So he turned away and he just went to one youngster asking one question. Please tell me, I have one question. He said, what is it? He says, where is Abdullah bin Rawaha? So the youngster says, you know what? He sacrificed greatly, bravely in Allah Ta'ala's way. He says, but tell me, is he back? Is he okay? He says, Alhamdulillah, he's safe and sound. That's all Abu Darda wanted to know. And the youngster also didn't find his question strange, because the relationship between the two was really strong. They had like brotherhood from their young days. They were contemporaries and they grew up together and always had that special love and time for each other. When the advent of Islam came, Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawaha radiallahu anhu embraced Islam, but Hazrat Abu Darda turned away. But Abdullah bin Rawaha did not leave an opportunity. So to say, he didn't leave a stone unturned in inviting his brother to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He explained to him Islam on many occasions, and it saddened him severely that his friend is on shirk and idolatry, ascribing partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyway, Abu Darda went to his trade, and as he was sitting there doing his business, telling his people what to do and so forth, at that time, Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawaha goes to his house to see where's Abu Darda. Abu Darda wasn't there, so it seems probably he went there for some different intention. He sees the door open and he sees Ummu Darda there in the courtyard. So he greets her, Assalamu alaykum ya Amatallah. She greets him, Wa alaykum assalam, O the brother of Abu Darda. So he asks her, where's Abu Darda? She says, you know, he's gone to his trade and he'll come sometime later, it won't be long. She says, do you allow me to enter? He says, yes. He asks her, she says, you know, you're welcome, ala rahbi wa sa'a. And he goes in and she carries on with the house. She knows that Abu Darda was very close to Abdullah bin Rawaha, and he was in and out of their house. And while she was occupied in everything, in her work, Abdullah bin Rawaha did something very, very strange and interesting. He tried very hard to inspire his brother, his friend, towards Islam. But he realized that it wasn't working. So now he wanted to use a different strategy, because he felt he was close to Abu Darda, and this would open the mind of Abu Darda. So he goes into the idol room of Abu Darda, and he addresses those idols saying that, what can you do? Everything besides Allah is batil. Everything besides Allah cannot do. You are man-made. And he starts crushing those idols and destroying them. And he was saying, Ala kullu ma yud'a ma Allahi batilu. There's an interesting hadith I was reading in Hakim, where Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Meccan stage meets a man by the name of Rifa'a. And Rifa'a says that, I was the first of the people of Medina to embrace Islam. He says, I actually saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Makkah, and I said to my cousin Mu'adh bin Afra, this is in Makkah, before Islam even entered Medina Munawwara, but we heard about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's da'wat. So I said to my brother, let's go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, maybe he'll keep our camel for us while we're gone for Hajj, maybe this good Arab man will help us. So they met Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they asked him, are you the one they're speaking about? Allah's Nabi says, yes, it is me. So Allah's Nabi seized the opportunity and said to Rifa'a, Rifa'a, I want you to tell me. He says, what is it? Oh Rifa'a, who created the mountains? I want an honest answer. He says, actually Allah. He says, oh Rifa'a, who created the earth? I responded, Allah. Who created the skies? Allah. Okay, Rifa'a, who made us? He says, I honestly answered. He asked me to respond honestly. I said, Allah. He says, okay. In that case, Rifa'a, the idols that people worship, who manufactured those? So Rifa'a says, I thought about it. And I said, you know what? In actual fact, we manufactured them and, you know, prepared them and carved them and so forth. So Allah's Nabi says, okay, I'm keeping your camels, but just think about it. Why don't we worship He who made us? And what we made, let those things worship us. Allahu Akbar. What a way of wisdom to break ice with people, to politely explain to people that the Allah who we have to worship is one and He has no partner and we all need to turn to Him. He made everything. He made us. And respected brother, sister, respected mother, father, we have to use the same strategy with all our friends, with our associates, with our employers, employees. Call them over. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made ikram, yeah. What was the ikram? Allah's Nabi kept a camel for them. The hadith is lengthy. He says Allah's Nabi was making our ikram. In that, this the companion of Rifa'a was so inspired by Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to Rifa'a, you carry on by the Kaaba. I'm sitting here by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, I went by the Kaaba. I was mind boggled by what he said, thinking about it, brainstorming it. What he says is true. I went by the Kaaba, he casted lots. This was what they would do in Jahiliyyah. He says, oh Allah, if this is true, show it to me. And as I casted those lots and I picked up my arrows, 7 times Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name came out. And I said, oh Allah, I bring Iman. By the Kaaba, I made an intention. Someone overheard me. He said, no, he's irreligious, don't follow him. Rifa'a says, I said to that individual, no, he is on truth. I returned where Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting. I find my cousin there was already convinced. So I said to them, yes, I also am bringing Iman. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam called us to Shahada, to Kalima, to Iman. And sitting there and then, he taught us Surah Yusuf and Surah Iqra, because these are early Meccan revealed chapters of the Quran Kareem. Iqra bismi Rabbik and Surah Yusuf. My point here is Allah's Nabi in so many ahadith, and here in this hadith specifically, teaches us how to break the ice with those employers, employees, friends, associates, neighbors, colleagues. Over a cup of tea, ask this individual, even if it's not in a congregation, just one-on-one, which is many a time more effective, because there isn't that herd instinct now that someone else is watching what they will say. Now this person's heart is open, his mind is open. Ask him, think, my brother, you speak to my brother, my sister, you speak to my sister, in the form of your neighbor, your friend, your associate. Ask that individual, hey, you know what, who made the skies? Who made the earth? Who created everything around us? And ask them, who created us? And we can explain to a person in such a beautiful manner through explaining oxygen, how we breathe in oxygen, breathe out carbon dioxide, how the honeybee prepares that honey. How is all of this happening? Did it happen by chance? No, there's a maker, there's a creator. Simple examples to make people think. And this is the duty of every ummati of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Surah Yusuf, we just mentioned now Surah Yusuf. I would love you to check it up. All of us should be connecting to Quran Kareem more and more. The month of Ramadan is coming. Surah Yusuf, ayah number 107. Allah says to His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, O Nabi of Allah, qul, tell them, O Nabi of Allah, hadihi sabili, this is my way, this is my path, this is my road. And Allah doesn't leave it ambiguous. O my Nabi, tell them, what is your path? Ad'u ila Allah, I am an inviter to Allah, ala basira, with wisdom and insight. Ana, this is my way, my work, my road, my path, my objective, my way of life. Sabili, ana, my way, wa man ittaba'ani, and everyone who follows me, this is his way. In Surah Ali Imran, Allah says to His beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell them, in kuntum tuhibbun Allah, if you claim you love Allah, fattabi'uni, follow me. Yeah, Allah is teaching His beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam to tell humanity, what do the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam do? Ana wa man ittaba'ani, that every opportunity take to introduce Allah to humanity and introduce Islam to humanity. Allah give us tawfiq. That's all it takes. Yesterday a friend of mine invited me. We had meals together. He called his friends who were with him in school. Now he's in his, these friends of mine are in their 50s. Their friends are the same. And it was the time of Isha. So we called the Adhan. And these were non, their friends were non-Muslim. So we said, come sit next to us, see how we pray. And if you like to join us, you're welcome. And after that they sat and they saw how we made sajda. They joined in the sajda. They said, no, the response and the reaction of these non-Muslims, we've never experienced something so enjoyable. And after the salah, we had a little discussion. Similar, just deducing from Rasulullah's Mubarak life. And then we also explained Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam's life in the Quran Kareem, how many times he's mentioned and so forth. At the end, I tell you, these non-Muslims were so affected by this. They said, please, we want to know more about Islam. We exchanged numbers. That's all it takes. Bring a person a little closer.